terrible evils and sufferings have always afflicted mankind. To name a few, there's the tragedy of 9/11 and the rise of terrorism, the slaughtering of Jews in the Holocaust, the millions of babies who are aborted yearly, the continual natural disasters such as devastating hurricanes, the addictions and deaths of many teens from drug use, and the slow and painful deaths of many by cancer. These are only some of the evils that afflict people in this world. How can all this evil and suffering exist if God is good, holy, omnipotent, and sovereign? This is a very important question that every Christian must have an answer for. Most Christians have an overly simple understanding of God's goodness amidst evil and doubt or even fall away from God when they face trials. Stated simply, the philosophical problem of evil goes like this. 1. If God is all-knowing, then he knows of all evil and its harmful effects. If God is all good, then he would prevent evil if he could. If God is all powerful, then he can prevent evil. Evil exists, therefore 1, 2, or 3, or some combination must be false. So we must reconcile the fact that evil and suffering exist with the truth that God is sovereign and loving. One of the attempts to reconcile the problem of evil is called the free will defense. It argues that God allowed for the possibility of evil because he needed to give man freedom of choice. The free will defense still counts God as all-powerful, but argues that even God could not create a world with no possibility of evil without ruining our free will. He needed to give us the freedom to willingly choose to serve him or to sin, otherwise we would just be like robots being forced to do what is right. In short, God decided it was better for us to have free will, even if that meant evil would likely exist. However, there is a more important reason that God allows evil, and it is a biblical reason given in Scripture. It is actually good that evil exists because of the greater good God can work about. While many Christians know that God can be glorified through how he works good out of evil, most think this glorification is simply incidental. It is rather that God intentionally and willfully chooses to allow evil, but more precisely ordains evil, with the specific purpose of displaying his love, justice, and mercy in such a way that would not be possible if evil didn't exist. Thus, contrary to the common thought that evil undermines God's goodness, God is actually more glorious for ordaining evil to exist. But first, what is evil? There are two types of evil: natural evil and moral evil. Natural evil we usually refer to as calamities, such as hurricanes, flood, disease, all the natural ways that misery strikes without human cause. Moral evil we usually refer to as sin, such as murder, lying, adultery, stealing, all the ways that people fail to love each other. So God is sovereign, but how far does his sovereignty extend over evil? Is he sovereign over natural evils and moral evils? The Scriptures are very clear that natural evils are under God's sovereignty. In fact, in the Scriptures, they are repeatedly described as being sent by God. Lamentations 3:37-38 says, "Who has spoken and it came to pass, unless the Lord has commanded it? Is it not from the mouth of the Most High that both good and bad come?" Ezekiel 5:17 says, "I will send famine and wild beasts against you, and they will rob you of your children." Amos 3:6 says, "Does disaster come to a city unless the Lord has done it?" Most Christians think that God just uses evil that occurs for his glory, but these verses suggest God is more involved than that. It can be his plan and will that certain evils happen. Regarding sickness and disability, which is another form of natural evil, John 9:2-3 reads, "His disciples asked him, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?' Jesus answered, 'It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him.'" This man was not born blind by bad luck or chance, but according to God's sovereign will that his works would be shown in the man, so he created him to be born blind. Therefore, natural evils are under God's sovereignty, so it is inaccurate to say he merely allows those evils when he has an intentional purpose for them. How can this relationship between God and evil be described? The word that many theologians use to explain this is ordain. Ordain means to set something that will continue in a certain order, or to decree or appoint. To say God ordains evil means he has chosen to make evil a part of his plan to fulfill certain purposes. It does not mean that God causes evil directly, authors evil, or desires that the evil happen for its own sake. From these passages, and there are many others in Scripture, it is evident that natural evils are indeed ordained by God. Are moral evils also ordained by God? In Genesis 50:20, Joseph speaks to his brothers after they sold him into slavery, and he became the one to deliver Egypt from the famine. It reads, "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about that many people should be kept alive, as they are today." Most Christians' understanding is that God just simply uses certain evils that occur for his glory. He just responds to evil that he has foreseen and then determines to work good out of it. Well, in this verse, we see something different. The word here is meant, not used. The Hebrew meaning of the word, which is hashav, ranges from weave to plan to intend or invent. The nature of the word is the intention to accomplish something before any action ever occurs. The word does not mean that God merely used the sins of Joseph's brothers for good, but that he purposed them for a greater good. So God didn't just use Joseph's enslavement for good, but it was always his predetermined will that it would happen, because he wanted to work a far greater good by saving everyone from the famine and showing his providence for them through it. What if God, in his perfect will and wise plan, ordains evil so he can work greater good in the universe? The account of Job is one of the best examples of how God indeed ordains evil. Job's wife comes and says, "Curse God and die because of the suffering." Job responds, "Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" Someone might protest and rebuke Job, saying, "Job, don't say that. God doesn't bring pain. It was Satan." However, the immediate context in Job says, "In all this, Job did not sin with his lips." Job got it right. Later, his friends came to comfort and show sympathy for the evil the Lord had brought upon him. Also worth noting is that God, not Satan, first initiated the conversation about Job. Chapter 1, verse 8 says, "The Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job?'" It's almost as if God wanted to provoke Satan into bringing calamity on Job, and when he asks to do it, God allows it. He saw what evil Job would experience, but still allowed it, and even initiated the conversation that resulted in Satan tormenting him. What should this action be called? If God foresees an evil will happen and has the authority and power to stop it, but doesn't, it is for a good predetermined reason. He is effectively ordaining it. Behind the allowing of God is a choice, and this choosing precedes his allowing. God actively chose to allow Job to suffer, and he actively chose to create a world that he knew would fall and be evil. If God chooses something, it's because it is his will that it happen. God never chooses something that is against his will. So in choosing to allow evil, God is ordaining it. But you might object, how can God be good while at the same time ordaining evil? This is a valid concern because the scriptures say that God is not the author of sin. He doesn't desire that the evil happen for its own sake, but only for the good he works through it. God is not justifying the evil, even if he's using it for good. Jonathan Edwards, one of the most influential theologians in American history, said, "Willing that sin exists in the world is not the same as sinning. God does not commit sin in willing that there be sin. He has established a world in which sin will indeed necessarily come to pass by God's permission, but not by his positive agency. God may hate a thing as it is in itself, and yet it may be his will it should come to pass, considering all consequences." So God does not ordain evil directly. He only does it indirectly, and he never acts evilly himself. God only ordains evil to work greater good. He never desires that the evil happen for its own sake. The Apostle Paul made a very shocking statement about God's hand in the crucifixion. Listen closely to this. Acts 4:27 through 28 says, "For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place." All the actions of those who crucified Jesus had been predestined by God. How could the crucifixion be a part of God's plan without him ordaining the sins of the people who killed him? Did God just foresee what sins would be committed and then decide to send Jesus as the sacrifice? Was the greatest good in the universe just a secondary result of God responding to an evil and then just using it for good? Did God just allow the crucifixion to happen? No, of course not. He planned and ordained that Jesus would be crucified. If God ordained the worst evil man ever committed, why wouldn't he ordain lesser evils? This idea of God ordaining the sins people commit is a theme throughout the scriptures. John Piper says, "God opposes hatred toward his people, yet ordained that his people be hated in Egypt. He hardens Pharaoh's heart, but commands him to let his people go. He makes plain that it is sin for David to take a military census of his people, but he ordains that he do it. He opposes adultery, but ordains that Absalom should lie with his father's wives. He forbids rebellion and insubordination against the king, but ordained that Jeroboam and the 10 tribes should rebel against Rehoboam. He opposes murder, but ordains the murder of his son." So evil serves a purpose in God's plan. He ordains both natural evil and moral evil to work greater good, which will glorify his name. But what are those greater goods? How exactly does evil result in God being glorified? First and foremost, God ordains evil to show his love, as backwards and ironic as that may seem. How could we possibly know his love for us to the degree that we do without Christ's sacrifice to save us from sin or evil? John 3:16, the most widely known verse in the Bible, says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son." This verse asserts that the ultimate display of God's love was seen in his son's sacrifice. But sacrificial love is only necessary if someone needs saving from some evil. If evil didn't exist and he didn't die for us, then we wouldn't know the depth of his love. This verse, and really the entire Christian faith, is centered around the sin we've committed and the death we deserve, but the love of God in saving us. Think about all the songs we sing, like "What Wondrous Love Is This?", "Amazing Grace," "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." We're rejoicing in the love God has shown us by saving us from some evil or sin. We wouldn't even have the feelings that inspire those songs to be written if evil never existed. Thus, God ordained evil to more fully show his love for us as sinners. Jesus himself emphasized the importance of sacrificial love in John 15:13, which says, "Greater love has no one than this, that someone laid down his life for his friends." Why is this the greatest love? Because Jesus laid down his life for us. If this is the greatest love, and it is only possible by man falling into sin, then is it not worth it for God to ordain evil so that he may show his love in the greatest form? Furthermore, one of Jesus' parables in Luke illustrates this point. A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now which of them will love him more? Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly. He who is forgiven little loves little." We see here that one who is saved from much sin will love and glorify God more than one who is saved from little sin. Thus, God ordained evil to cause us to come to him for forgiveness and salvation so that he would be glorified. In a world without evil, our knowledge of God's amazing love and work of redemption would be very shallow, and we couldn't possibly know his love for us to the degree that we do. Evil also serves other purposes in God's plan. Through it, he shows his wondrous mercy and justice in his wrath over sin. Romans 9:22 through 23 says, "God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory. God also ordained evil and suffering to increase our faith in him and grow more godliness in us. 1 Peter 1:6-7 says, "You have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Therefore, God is more glorious for ordaining evil because of those greater goods which he works through it." Imagine Christianity without any knowledge of God's love, justice, power, and wrath. If evil didn't exist, why would we have any reason to love God? Would we be grateful and happy that he forgave us of our sin and provided a way of eternal life? Therefore, evil doesn't exist just because there is no other way for God to give us free will. No, rather, God ordained evil to be a part of his plan so that he could display his glory most fully to us. In conclusion, God is worthy of our praise and worship for how he wisely ordained evil to glorify himself. And armed with this understanding that God ordains evil for wise purposes, we will have increased confidence and persevere when facing trials and suffering, because we rest assured God is doing what's best and is not any less glorious for allowing evil to exist. For the present time, evil serves a purpose in God's plan, but he does not intend it to afflict us forever. He truly hates evil and has promised that there will be a day when there will be no more suffering, when he will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. In closing, John Piper says, "If you would see God's glory and savor his glory and magnify his glory in this world, do not remain wavering before the sovereignty of God in the face of great evil. Take his book in your hand, plead for his spirit of illumination and humility and trust, and settle this matter, that you might be unshakable in the day of your own calamity. In the day of your loss, be like Job, who, when he lost all his children, fell down and worshiped and said, 'The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.'"
What is the reason that you feel it's necessary to go beyond a free will defense to kind of pushing that line of putting evil the way you're using it, that God ordains it, rather than using just a statement that God allows it?
So I think using the word allow the way we do to describe God's relationship to evil is a little too passive, because it doesn't capture that aspect of it and that God uses it for his plan. And so you have it, it's more like you come to this point where it's like God is just, he sees an evil happen and he's like, "Oh well, I guess I'll allow it, so be it. I have no other option, I have to give him free will." Whereas this other aspect of it is that God actually, though he did not desire it, he intended for that evil to happen so he could work this greater good, and allowing does not capture that as using the word ordain does.
Is there a line that you can go too far in when you're describing that God is no longer good?
Oh yeah, most definitely.
So where's that line?
The line is hard to draw, because as I was saying God ordains evil, probably most people here started to lean towards thinking I was saying God causes evil, and I'm not saying that in any means. God does not directly cause evil, and he really doesn't cause evil. But God is still good, because he indirectly makes it part of his plan that certain evils happen, such as the crucifixion. That was a great evil, but it says in Isaiah 53 that it was the will of the Lord to crush him. It was the will of the Lord that this great sin would happen. And it's that fine line in between cause and allow. It's neither one, it's in between, and it's hard to, it's honestly hard to describe it, right? With like the definition of an ordain that I gave, it's still tricky.
So another thing you said was that God allows evil so that he can bring about good. mean, does that mean that God's not omnipotent? Does that mean that he's limited in what he can do and how he can do it?
No, it doesn't like make something possible for God, because everything is possible for God. He can do anything. But what it does is it makes it so we can see his glory. God is not actually more glorious for ordaining evil. He's only seen to be more glorious for ordaining evil. So we see more of God's character through him ordaining those things. It's not that God is actually greater for allowing this. It's actually that we just see his glory more fully. Yeah. He's not actually more glorious. He's just seen to be more glorious.
Okay. It's for our benefit.
Yeah, for our benefit.
You say God does not cause evil, and yet God hardened Pharaoh's heart. God hardened the hearts of the Herod and Pontius Pilate and the Jewish leaders that brought about the crucifixion. I don't see that as just ordaining. How is that different? I mean, he actually basically says that he actually took action and did something.
Yes. The way I think when he's hardening Pharaoh's heart, it seems that God's actively doing something, and he is. What he's doing is he's not causing Pharaoh to sin. He's removing his mercy from Pharaoh. It basically, because all of mankind is inclined to sin naturally by their nature, if God didn't have mercy on people, then there would just be infinite chaos and everyone would be sinning. So God, in hardening Pharaoh's heart, was removing his mercy from Pharaoh in allowing Pharaoh to behave according to his sinful nature. And so it was Pharaoh doing what he did, but God just said, like, so be it, I'll remove my mercy from him. And so it's in that sense that God's hardening his heart.
Wouldn't the greatest good be a world where there just isn't evil? I mean, wouldn't that be the greatest good possible?
Well, I would say it actually wouldn't be, because we wouldn't see God's character displayed, all those attributes that I gave, and that we wouldn't see God's love, his justice, his mercy. We wouldn't see all those things if evil didn't exist, or at least we wouldn't know it to the degree that we do. And so, I mean, it'd be a world without John 3:16. It'd be a world without the cross, and how we get to experience salvation and love for God. It would be a world without all those. So I would say it would be a lesser good. It would not be the greatest good if evil didn't exist.
Why would it be a world like that? Why couldn't he just make us to know those things? To understand all that.
I feel like that's like contradictory to the laws of like how things work.
Okay.
Because if you can't just, someone tells you, oh, so-and-so loves you, and you don't even know them, you haven't met them, you're like, okay, but you have no idea, you have not experienced it from that person. So yeah, I don't think that's possible.
All right, thank you. If I choose to oppose someone's evil actions, am I interfering with God's will? Should I just let people do what they're going to do because it's part of God's plan, and who am I to decide that this shouldn't be happening?
God obviously prefers that we don't sin. He's commanded us to obey him. So it's kind of like God's preferred will. It's his will. There's like God's will of command and his will of decree. God will command that we obey him, but his will of decree may be that certain evils happen, because like the cross, so that he can work greater good. So God wants us to lead people to him, and so that they wouldn't sin, and so we would be sinning if we didn't do that. And so that's, yeah.
Very good, thank you. Yeah.
Micah, you have represented the Reformed position fairly well, so well done. You are finished.